This is part two of using the square root property of equations to solve quadratic equations, and we solve the following three equations on this video. This is part two of the square root property of equations. We're using the square root property to solve quadratic equations, and the square root property says if a squared equals b, then a equals plus or minus square root of b. Let's just start off with a problem again, just to recall how to do these. Let's see, I have x squared plus 5 equals 1. How would I solve this using this property? Well, I need to have something in the form, just something squared equals a number, and I have an x squared plus 5, so my first step is to subtract 5 from both sides. So we have x squared equals negative 4. Now remember, if we only knew about real numbers, we would stop right here, because when you square a real number, it's not negative. But we've worked with complex numbers and imaginary numbers, so we could keep going. So now I've isolated the x squared, so I can take the square root of both sides. Remember, it's up to you if you want to do that little step where you write the square root to remind yourself what you're doing, taking the square root of both sides. But it doesn't mean that x is the square root of negative 4, it means that it's plus or minus. Remember, it's very important to put the plus or minus, the square root of negative 4. Now, can we simplify the square root of negative 4? Well, remember, if you have a minus sign underneath the square root, that would be the square root of 4 times I, because I is the square root of negative 1. And square root of 4 we could also simplify, so this is plus or minus 2i. This gives us two solutions. X can either be 2i or negative 2i. Now let's make sure that these are correct. I'm just going to do a check on one of the solutions. Alright, so I'm going to go ahead and check negative 2i in for x. So I'm going to plug in negative 2i for x. And we need to simplify this side. So negative 2i squared, remember that means negative 2i times negative 2i, which is 4i squared. And what's I squared? That's negative 1. And what's 4 times negative 1? Negative 4. And what's negative 4 plus 5? 1. Notice I'm writing down the plus 5, plus 5, plus 5 all the way down the problem. You want to make sure you're just showing your steps. This one right here you might not show. You might just go right to 4i squared. All right, now, right-hand side. There's a 1 and that's it. So, yes, negative 2i did check. And if you put in 2i, it would also check. So, therefore, our solutions are going to be 2i and negative 2i. Those were correct. So that's a little, we're just recalling the types of problems we did on the previous video in part one, except that we hadn't come up with any problems that had imaginary numbers. This is the first time the solutions were complex. All right, up here at the top, if a squared equals b, then a equals plus or minus square root of b. Remember, that's the square root property. So now let's solve x minus 3 squared equals 4. All right, you might want to square x minus 3. But actually, you've got this in a nice form. It has something squared, except instead of just an a or an x, I have an x minus 3 squared. So just keep in mind, this is what you have squared, that x minus 3. So we have x minus 3 squared equals 4. So I could use the square root property. I could take the square root of both sides. And then if you take the square root of an x minus 3 squared, you just get x minus 3 equals, remember to put the plus or minus, and what's the square root of 4? 2. Now at this point you have to break up the equation into two separate equations, because this says x minus 3 can be a 2 or x minus 3 can be negative 2. So that's exactly what you write. Remember to write two separate equations. X minus 3 equals 2, or x minus 3 equals negative 2. And so we solve each of these, and add 3 to both sides. to get x equals 5. And let's see, on the other one, also I'm going to add 3 to both sides. But this gives me x equals 1. So it looks like I've got two solutions, 1 or 5. Now, we have to check this. Each solution in the original equation, which was x minus 3 squared equals 4. So let's do that. All right, so we're going to first check x equals 5. You could put the video on pause and check it yourself if you'd like. So we're going to put in 5 for x. Now, remember, that is not 5 squared minus 3 squared. You have to use order of operations. Subtract inside parentheses, so that's 2 squared. You could keep the parentheses around the 2, but it's unnecessary. And 2 squared is 4. And on the right side, I've got 4. So that means, yes, that checked out, right? Now let's plug in 1 for x. 1 minus 3 squared. And again, we have to simplify inside the parentheses. 1 minus 3 is negative 2. And keep in mind, negative 2, if that's in parentheses squared, it means you got to do negative 2 times negative 2. So that's also 4. And so that one checks as well. So both of these checked. So yes, the solution for both numbers, 5 or negative 1. Both of those are solutions. All right, let's have you try 1 on your own. Before going on, just keep in mind, if you would have squared x minus 3 and solved this by setting it equal to 0, you would get exactly the same solution. So before we go on to another problem, let's just show that that's not the only way you could have done this, x minus 3 squared equals 4. All right, so let's say you didn't know the square root property. You could have multiplied x minus 3 squared out, which will be x squared minus 6x plus 9. Remember, you're squaring a binomial, so it's x minus 3 times x minus 3. And then you could have set the equation equal to 0 by subtracting 4 from both sides and then factored the x squared minus 6x plus 5. So that's x minus 1 times x minus 5 equals 0. Set it equal to 0, each factor. And you would have gotten the same solutions, 1 or 5. So in this particular problem, it would have also worked by doing it this way, by doing it by factoring. But for the next one, it will not. So we're going to have to use the square root property. So see if you could do this one by taking the square roots of both sides. Remember your plus or minus, and put the video on pause and try it first on your own. Okay, so here we go. We're going to take the square root of both sides. And when you do that, don't forget to put plus or minus in front of this square root. Now, I can't simplify the square root of 5, so I'm just going to have to write square root of 5. So this gives us two separate solutions. Either x plus 3 is square root of 5, or x plus 3 is minus square root of 5. Now, when it's a number, when it's something in square root, a lot of times people just subtract 3. They put it in front, subtract 3 from both sides, and they write it in front over here of the plus or minus, which is okay, but notice that gives you two solutions. Negative 3 plus the square root of 5 is one solution, and negative 3 minus the square root of 5 is the other solution. Let's check the first solution in the original problem. Anytime you solve any kind of an equation, you should always check each solution. All right, so here we go. What are we going to plug in for x? We're going to plug in negative 3 plus square root of 5 for x. And then I finish copying the rest of the problem on the left of the equal sign. Now, order of operations, you do inside parentheses first. Notice negative 3 plus 3 is 0, so this just gives me square root of 5 squared. And square root of 5 squared is 5. So there you go. It checks. Okay? So our solutions were correct. I didn't check the other solution, but you can also check the other solution and it will also work. So there are two solutions to this problem. All right, go on to part 3 and we're just going to step it up a little bit more, do a few more examples using the square root property.